A long timeline ago, this is the history of Star Wars spaceflight simulators. Star Wars has had a nearly 40-year history with video games, from the earliest releases of The Empire Strikes Back on the Atari 2600 in 1982, to the latest release, Star Wars Squadrons, coming to Xbox One, PS4, and PC next month. And while there have been over 150 different Star Wars video games for various platforms over the years, we're focusing on the dozens of titles that let you step into the cockpit of a starfighter. However, while flying levels have always been a part of Star Wars games, we're focusing on the ones that primarily revolved around flying, which means we won't be touching on racers or expansion packs for ground-based games, like Battlefront II's Starfighter Assault or the Old Republic's Galactic Starfighter. With the release of Star Wars Return of the Jedi in 1983, Star Wars decided to dip its toes into this newfangled video game fad the same year with the arcade hit Star Wars. Using vector-based graphics similar to what the United States military had been using in their own simulators, the Star Wars arcade game puts you in the cockpit of Luke's X-Wing as you fly through three different levels in your mission to blow up the Death Star. And while more games followed over the years, the next time you would get a true flying sim was 2 years later in 1985 with the sequel arcade game The Empire Strikes Back. It would be nearly 6 years before another cockpit-based sim would be released in Star Wars Attack on the Death Star, which mimicked the vector graphics of the arcade game for home PCs. Then, in 1993, everything changed. Following Sega's 32X release of the reimagined Star Wars arcade game, LucasArts released a genre-defining hit with Star Wars X-Wing. The game gave you complete control of the ship, for the first time letting you fly in 3D space without the constraint of a predetermined path of the previous arcade games. Two expansion packs followed, leading to the new game Star Wars Rebel Assault, an on-rail shooter that puts you in the shoes of Rookie One, a hotshot X-Wing pilot who has a very similar backstory to Luke Skywalker. 1994 brought us the sequel to X-Wing, TIE Fighter, letting you get a taste for the Empire's side in these endless Star Wars, with 95 bringing us the sequel, Rebel Assault 2, The Hidden Empire. 1997 rounded out the X-Wing TIE Fighter trilogy with X-Wing vs. TIE Fighter, now with multiplayer. In 1998, the world was waiting for the first new Star Wars film, The Phantom Menace. But in the meantime, we got Star Wars Rogue Squadron for the Nintendo 64. Cool thing about this game is that the Naboo Starfighter was hidden in the code and unlockable with a password when the game shipped, 3 full days before the first trailer for The Phantom Menace was released in theaters. Crazy part is the ship stayed hidden and unfound in the code until the developer released the cheat code, after the movie was released in theaters. 1999 saw the release of X-Wing Alliance, the quasi-sequel to TIE Fighter and X-Wing vs. TIE Fighter, including a Shadows of the Empire mission where you assist pouch enthusiast Dash Rendar. Because late 90s Star Wars. Battle for Naboo lets you get behind the controls of a Naboo Starfighter without a cheat code on the N64 in 2001, as well as Star Wars Starfighter, a prequel-era spaceflight sim, closing out the year with Rogue Squadron 2, Rogue Leader on GameCube, and Jedi Starfighter, the sequel to Starfighter. In 2003, if you needed a flying fix on the go, you could play Flight of the Falcon on Game Boy Advance, and that same year saw the third and final game in the Rogue Squadron trilogy, Rebel Strike. It would be nearly 13 years before we got a fully dedicated flying game, when Star Wars Battle Pod was released in arcades in 2015. Now, 5 years later, we're finally getting a brand new spaceflight combat game, Star Wars Squadrons, where you can once again jump into ship cockpits of both the New Republic and Empire, living out your own fighter pilot fantasy, complete with Ewok bobbleheads. Want to learn more about Star Wars Squadrons? Well, then you're in luck, because Anthony Carboni is about to chat with the game's creative director, Ian Fraser. Take it away, Anthony.